So yesterday, Yehuda talked about how our actions encode our values. They show our colleagues, our friends, our users, what we believe. When we write our tests and make our websites accessible, we're doing that because we want them to work. And we choose frameworks that make that easier, right? We share the code that makes our software work really well. And it's just really been a privilege to be part of this community for the last couple of days. But the outside world isn't always like this. And we live in a world where sometimes hype eclipses reality. Something new was invented yesterday, and there are headlines, and you've been doing it for 8 years. And that's hard. And sometimes it just doesn't seem like anybody wants to hear about all the messy details that make things work. When your stuff works well, that sometimes seems like it's not good enough. And it can be confusing about what are the things that we should really be doing, and sometimes it can be hard to stick to your values. And maybe you've experienced a time when there was some heroic team who worked nights and weekends to save the company with their thing, and maybe you've been part of one of those teams. I know I have. And at the time, sometimes I didn't notice that there was another team that just shipped good code with no fuss. They just got the job done. And sometimes they didn't get applauded. And I don't like that. I've been thinking a lot these days about what it means to be heroic. And I think that we choose our heroes. We choose what stories to tell and retell or retweet. And I think our heroes are born through our storytelling. We choose what is legendary. And I think there's an opportunity to reinvent that. And I'm going to tell you some stories about things that I think are heroic. And unusual, but born out of the ordinary. Born out of things that just regular software engineers did and do. And, you know, like, reality is really messy. And it feels like all these details are boring. But I think, and having been a mom, I think I can say this, that reality is awesome. The messiness is what makes it, is like mixed in there with the awesomeness. If it wasn't hard, it wouldn't be awesome. And so, I'm all grown up now. You know, I had a kid and things didn't turn out. I mean, he turned out great. But like the world didn't turn out the way I thought it was gonna be. This isn't what people told me things were gonna be like. And when I reflect on these things, especially the last couple of years, I think to myself, like, how did it get to be that reality is so broken? But I want to share with you the only thing I think we can do if you feel this way. That we need to change the rules. We have an opportunity to change a little bit of reality. So, as programmers, we make up rules all the time. Routes and model hooks are rules that some Ember folks made up. And these rules become incredibly concrete, even though they're just made up of words and atoms and things. And so I'm going to start with some like computer science-y stuff, and then I'm going to talk about really not computer science-y things. But in computer science terms, so we talk about these rules as abstractions. And I read up about abstractions, and as it turns out, in 1974, before I was coding, Barbara Liskov was the first one to start talking about programming abstractions. So in those days, she was working on an operating system, and she was working to make it maintainable and making it modular, and she realized that a lot of the ideas that she was putting in her operating system were different from the things she was reading about what other people were doing. And so she started writing papers about it. And one of the things that she invented was abstract data types. And this is from that paper. And she said that what we desire from an abstraction is a mechanism which permits the expression of relevant details and suppresses the irrelevant details. In the case of programming, the use which may be made of an abstraction is relevant, and the implementation details are not. And so you can look back and imagine what this is like. I have a hard time imagining an era where that was a new thought. She's also famous, just as a sidebar, for the Liskov substitution principle, which was that if you have a class and you subclass it, that you ought to be able to substitute either one in a program and have it function correctly. And so this is basically a test of your abstraction. And this was an era where people used GoTo to structure their code. And personally, I have trouble like conceptualizing GoTo and structure like in the same sentence coherently. But I find it really interesting to think back on how that was and be really appreciative that now we live in a different world. And she said that she really wanted to make it so that it would be easy for people to write good programs. And it's not, of course, it's not impossible to write bad programs, but the easy path should be the good path. So I'd like you to think about all the abstractions you use when you write code. And the classes that you subclass and the patterns that you use as you write these things down. These are the rules that we live by as programmers. And I think as programmers, it's sort of fascinating that we get to make up a lot of the rules that we live by. You know, I mean, sometimes we have a job and stuff and other people get to make up some of the rules, but we get to invent things that didn't exist if we need them, and then they exist and then we have new rules to live by. And I think that that's really neat, and it makes me feel like a superhero when I write code. But sometimes the abstractions can get in our way. Sometimes there's bugs in the system. And Kent Beck tweeted this, which is first you learn the value of abstraction, then you learn the cost of abstraction, and then you're ready to engineer. So I'm going to talk about two things, which are how do we recognize when our abstraction is wrong, right? Sometimes we think we got it, and it's not the pattern that we meant to encode. And sometimes there's bugs in the system, and we have to sort of sort through which layer of the abstraction is incorrect or has a flaw in it. And I'm going to talk about things that aren't code, but where I think that our unique skills as programmers, this practice of redefining rules was particularly handy, and some things that I did with programmers or witnessed being done. So I said reality's broken. What I really mean is that our perception is not reality, but we live in this strange world where sometimes our perception then creates reality, and that can be like really hard to reason about. So I'm going to tell you a couple of stories about what changed my thinking about how we reason about what is real and what is truth, and you know, and how we encode that in data. So the first story is from the Smithsonian. So I went there in 2013 and had the opportunity to work with 8 museums, archives, and libraries. And one of them was the Natural History Museum. And it was just the same summer that they were opening their Curious exhibit. And this is a fabulous exhibit. If you're ever in DC, you have to go check it out. It's hands-on, exploratory kind of thing. And Robert Costello, who was then the head of outreach for the Natural History Museum, who is himself a scientist, took me on a little pre-opening tour. And while we're walking through there, he reaches into a drawer and pulls out this like ancient mammal skull and hands it to me. And I'm like, wow, is this a replica? This is so cool. And he says, no, that's a real skull. And I'm like, whoa, should I have gloves on? And he said, no, we just use that for the kids because it has no value to science. How could this thing that's like a million years old that I'm holding in my hands have no value to science? And he said, well, we don't know where it was found. And because we don't know geographically where it was found, we don't know who found it really, so that we don't really know the care that they took with recording it, because obviously they didn't record it because somebody dropped it off at the Natural History Museum or something. And that was new to me, the idea that if you didn't know what they call the provenance of an object, right? Like who found it, where it was found, when it was found, like all the details that place it in history and on our planet, then you don't really know anything. And I've puzzled about that for like 7 years. And the Smithsonian has like 300 million things, and very small percentage of them are used for education. Most of them are collected so that we can reflect on our natural history, on our world, on our society, because we can't really, it's generally believed that we can't assess things accurately without the passage of time. And in fact, maybe we can't really assess things accurately at all. And having some self-awareness that what we hold to be true is just our closest approximation at the moment, and that those truths change over time as we learn more. And so I was also involved with the archives, where they have, I think, hundreds of thousands of linear feet of paper, if you like stack it like this. And they're in all these boxes, and you can, like, anybody, any member of the public can go and, like, look in their catalog and ask, and they'll bring a box of papers to you to look at. And what we were doing was sort of accelerating the digitization process by engaging volunteers from online to look at some of these archival material that had not been really cataloged. So there was this travelogue that was by Doris Cochran, who was a herpetologist in the Natural History Museum in the 60s. And she went on this trip to South America in 1962, and this was her travelogue. And you can see that, I mean, we don't even have, I don't know, anybody keep a journal? A few people? Anybody keep one, like, in writing? Ah, good. Some of you do. So maybe like someday somebody will like look at your written artifact. And what's really fascinating about this is people are, this is just like a little side note, you notice that there's like metadata at the top of each page with the date and the location and the weather. A lot of people did this. And so there's a whole different group of people looking at ships' logs and people's journals to understand the weather patterns of the old times and turning these artifacts into a different sort of data. So I don't know what we're doing in our digital world. In fact, I know we're not doing enough to like capture all of our information and knowledge that is slowly, quickly dissipating. But anyhow, one of the great mysteries that I learned a lot about, it made me kind of understand archives a lot more and make me think about data, is that the inscription in this travelogue said to Doris, but this was Doris Cochran's travelogue, so how could that be? And one of the volunteers was like, oh, we made an error. So We went to the back of the archives and we pulled out the box that has the travel log in it. And in that box was the National Science Foundation grant. It turned out that Doris Cochran had a companion who went with her, Mrs. Sydney Blake. And we looked up Sydney Blake, who went to Harvard and was a botanist and a man, so not the same person. And it turned out that this was his wife. And I hadn't really thought about how hard it is to track. I mean, it's hard enough that women are written out of history, but the fact that it's hard to even tie their work together because so many things are tagged with somebody's name. And the art museums had problems because if your name isn't like a English name, then sometimes it's spelled differently in the different museums. And so it's very challenging how we represent humans. And we ended up actually, one of the archivists like triangulated this particular other Doris by looking at handwriting samples and other information. And so we have these abstractions, right? Is your name relevant or irrelevant? Is a name an accurate representation of a human? Well, not really, but it's sort of hard because we don't have unique identifiers. So I thought a lot about, you know, like, what does it mean? What's relevance? How do we even represent data? How do we think about humans? And it's sort of, you know, like, this disturbing things are going on. You know, like, we just had Black History Month, and, you know, all the white people in America are like, oh, there are Black people who weren't Martin Luther King in history. And it's, you know, I've made some mistakes myself where I have realized that I learned very little in history in high school. And we're sort of like, as a society, at least some of us starting to realize that like our default setting for human isn't white male, and like maybe there isn't a default setting for human. Like maybe we should just like all learn about each other and treat each other like we figure out what we're about. And there was this like tweet that a friend of mine showed me when I was preparing for this talk about AOC that was about how she was underwater with every demographic group except for women, non-whites, and 18 to 30. So it turns out that there's one group. Like, you know, like sometimes you have to like really think hard about the news we hear. So there's like wrong abstractions, right? There's things that are just like not the right way to look at the world. And this is, you know, back to computer science again. Sandy Metz talks a lot about refactoring. Like, I was learning things from reading her blog posts and, you know, the stuff she wrote in her books. And she talks about how you tell something is the wrong abstraction because it's a condition-laden procedure which interleaves a number of vaguely associated ideas. So, like, if people are grasping at straws to explain things, you might be like, maybe there's a wrong abstraction here. If your code has a lot of parameters and if-then-elses, then, you know, that's a sign. So reading about this and kind of thinking about why is this so persistent? Why is it that when I was a little girl and I learned about sexism, because, you know, like, they teach you that, like, everything's fair when you're a kid, even though you know it's not. I was like, oh, we just have to wait for all the old people to die, and then things will change. And that didn't happen. And so it turns out there's this hypothesis, which now it's so well proven in the research, they just call it a fallacy, which is the just world fallacy. So researchers have found that when people observe suffering, especially like innocent people suffering, they tend to both derogate and blame the victim. And that this is something that is like, they've done all sorts of different tests and it seems to be kind of a human phenomenon. which is horrible. And in the 60s, Melvin Lerner hypothesized that the belief in a just world is crucially important for us humans to maintain our own well-being. Because it's just too scary to think that it doesn't make any sense. We want to overlay sense on the world, but we're every day confronted that the world isn't just, that people suffer needlessly all the time. And we want to believe that things are fair. So you might have heard at some point in the last few years, people were talking about open source as a meritocracy. It turns out that that word came from a satirical novel where they were talking about the aristocrats in England and how they thought that they had merited all the things they had, and that when they did better, it was because of some objective measure. And people have studied this now, and it turns out that simply holding this belief seems to promote your being discriminated against people unfairly. Like, isn't that crazy? If you think things are fair, you're more likely to be unfair. And you also tend to make decisions that harm yourself. I had this experience last year where somebody was treating me like in a way that was unexpected, and I was like, wow, he seems smart. I don't know why he's acting so incompetent. And then I was like, could it be that he's sexist? There weren't any other women who interact with this man, so it's hard to tell. And then I realized, like, and I puzzled about this for like weeks. And then I realized that sexism and racism are incompetence. Like, there's, like, it's not either or. It's if you are working with somebody and you are disparaging their work or ignoring their work based on things that have nothing to do with their work, like, that's totally incompetent. And then that made it much easier, so. Phew. So there's a bunch of different words for this kind of pattern matching we do. And humans will often see patterns where they don't exist, and they call it apophenia or patternicity. And there's, you know, and that's kind of like a false positive. And then there's a false negative where there is a pattern, but you don't see it. And the false negatives are much more rare amongst humans. It's much more common that, you know, like we'll see Tomster in a slice of toast. I'm sure you've all seen him. And so the researchers think, and it seems credible, that this is because it would be very dangerous for us to miss a pattern. But if we accidentally see a pattern that's not there, it's not really dangerous because we're on alert and that's cool. So that really, this, you know, this like this ability to see patterns causes us to, like, we're always searching for meaning in the world, and that our biggest challenge might be actually learning to tolerate that things don't make sense. So I think that the world isn't fair. But in this context, I think the opposite of just is not unjust, even though the world is also unjust. But I think it's just terribly frightening to live in a world that doesn't make sense. But I like to think of it as imperfect or unfinished. And maybe there are just some significant bugs that need fixing. So I'm going to tell you a couple stories about changing the rules. So the first is from San Francisco Ruby Meetup, where in April 2009, I went to my first Ruby Meetup, where I personally doubled the number of women in the room. Whoops, there were 70 people, two women. I think that's 3%. But I had read, you know, like I came from kind of like the proprietary software world before, well, not really proprietary, but, you know, working for companies doing things. And I knew from the Department of Labor that the number of women in computing fields was like 25%, but I had read two different studies that said that the number of women contributing to open source in any way, even like documentation, community management, like talking on the mailing lists, was 2 to 3%. So I was like, oh, well, the Ruby community seems cool, but like maybe it's just that it's open source software. So a few weeks later, I actually applied for a scholarship because I was new to the Ruby community, and I went to the Golden Gate Ruby conference, and there were 200 people, 6 women, 3%. And thank you, Leah, who gave me a scholarship to go to the Golden Gate Ruby conference in 2009. This comes full circle. So the woman that I'd met at the first Ruby meetup I went to, Sarah May, was also at this conference, and we did some math. And I was like, well, you know, like I kind of been meaning to learn Ruby on Rails for a while before I ended up having to do it for work. So maybe we could just like teach people, because I know there are statistically more women in the Bay Area than there are Ruby programmers. Like more women software engineers, right? So we're like, we can just convert some. So so we set out to do this, and we held a workshop. 83 people signed up. We had like 20 spots. Turns out that when you're like, oh yeah, 60 women want to learn how to code, we got a lot of volunteers and it was cool. People like gave us money, and we had this like fabulous workshop, and then we just kept doing it. Sarah and I had made a pact that we were going to do this for a year. We're going to do it every month, but then we ended up doing it every other month. And I wish I could attribute this. I read it once on the internet, but I love this. Iterate, celebrate. Iterate, celebrate. You should always celebrate every iteration. So she gave this talk because by December, like we were tracking the number of women who came to these Ruby meetups, that we had reached 18% women, and they weren't all from the workshop. We were attracting women to be teachers of the workshops, and more people just kept showing up because they were more fun, because it was just more people who were, you know, having more interesting conversations. There was more, you know, beginners and experts having conversations with each other. People kind of knew each other more because they were teaching these workshops together. And she said her advice was to focus on something you can fix. And so I think that this was the secret. Like, we just were like, okay, we're going to do this little thing. And it's part of a big problem, but we're just going to solve it for our community in San Francisco. And I'd add to that that finding good people to work with is the best thing. Like, that, you know, like, then at worst case, if you totally fail it, you've worked with this, like, really neat person and done something together. And, you know, making things together with good people, like, that's always good. So we ended up, like, you know, Rails Bridge workshops kind of went viral and inspired all these other groups. And then Bridge Foundry has been going on for almost 10 years. And it's epic. But I want to zoom in on that, like, you know, 2010. When Sarah gave that talk, February 2010, we had been, like, blogging and talking and tweeting. And that, like, crystallization with data, right, the story, the recipe, all the things. About a year later, I was at the Lean Startup Conference, and I was curious to talk to Eric Ries, because he had kind of a similar kind of movement in parallel, the whole Lean Startup thing. And I was like, I wanted to ask him about it, because I was like, yeah, well, we're doing this Rails Bridge thing. And he said, are you that, Sarah? And I was like, maybe. And he said, who gave that talk? You know, about SF Ruby getting to 18%? I was like, oh, no, that's the other Sarah. And I was like, why? And he said, I don't want to offend you. So I was like, go ahead, tell me. But he said, you know, I heard that talk, or I saw the blog post, and I went right back to my next, like, lean startup organizing group. And I said to them, I can't imagine a group more geeky than the San Francisco Ruby meetup. And if they can do it, why can't we? And that set them off on a path to create diversity in the Lean Startup Conference, which I witnessed, and it was exciting. And then a couple of years later, I heard Todd Park, the CTO of the United States, speak at the Lean Startup Conference. And he talked about innovation in the US government, which I never thought I would hear those two words together. And he ended up recruiting me to become a Presidential Innovation Fellow in 2013. And one of the ways he recruited me is he said that if, well, one is he thought I could help, which I thought was a little bizarre, because, like, I don't know. I just didn't feel like I knew how to fix government software. But I guess, sure, they have web apps, I guess. But he said that if ever there was something, some, you know, bureaucracy that we couldn't hack, that we could escalate to this man. And so I was like, if the president thinks that I, you know, can help, who am I to say no? And then, you know, we got to government, and people like Erie Meyer, who was working at the White House at the time, kind of helped talk about how we fix these things. And we were prepped for the inevitable day that one of our government colleagues would say, you can't do that, it's illegal. So, because you're trying to do something that is just like normal. Like Mike Dickerson used to say, he was like a part of the healthcare.gov crew, like, he was like, well, on the planet where I'm from, this is normal. We release several times a day. So 18F, which was sort of created out of our Presidential Innovation Fellows group, kind of encoded how to think about laws and how to teach all of us programmers how to reason about the legal system and the policies and laws and stuff that we didn't understand. And they were very intrigued and excited to learn about what we meant when we said we were recruiting full-stack developers. And we had just a few people who understood policy in the government, and they called themselves full-stack bureaucrats. And so I want to share with you the bureaucratic stack. So at the top of the stack is practice. This is what we do. This is like just what people do day to day. It turns out that if you work for the government, the reason you have a job is because Congress passed a law. So you kind of need to do your job, or it's kind of illegal. And if you don't do your job, if you do something like outside of the bounds of normal practice, it might be illegal. And so, like in the government, it's very hard to get fired and scarily easy to break the law. In the private sector, it's fairly hard to break the law. Like you have like all these cushions of lawyers around you, and but pretty easy to get fired. And it just, it, you know, it makes me think. So after practice, there's guidance, right? So your supervisor, the supervisor of your group might write some guidance, like do this, don't do that. Your legal counsel of your agency might write some guidance. Sometimes the White House writes guidance. And then there's policy. So policy is more official, right? So if you don't obey guidance, it's like not that big a deal. You're just taking some risks and you should probably get some advice. But policies are like written down and reviewed by a bunch of people, and like, you can't really do something against policy. You can do something that's maybe not described by policy, but if it's in policy, you can't, like, go against it. Although sometimes you can find another policy that says you can do it, so that's kind of interesting. And then there's, like, kind of, like, below the line, the stuff that is, like, pretty hard to change. So there's regulations, which might be from an agency, or the Office of Management and Budget sometimes makes regulations for the whole government, federal government. Executive branch, and then there's laws, which Americans will know. We need an act of Congress to pass. And then there's the Constitution, which can get amended, but that was like kind of outside of the bounds of my term of service to consider. So this kind of helped reason about some things. And like, just as an example, I was doing a little project, and I thought it would be nice to have an advisory board from, you know, people who understand this kind of tech. And so I mentioned this to a friend of mine who worked at the White House, and she said, that's illegal. But she's like one of us. So I was like, can you explain this to me? I don't understand. She's like, well, it's FACA. People said that like in a scary tone. So apparently Congress passed a law, an act, the Federal Advisory Board Council Act, that came from an era when, you know, the back rooms, like people would meet secretly and influence our government officials, right? So we don't want that. So instead, if the government wants advice from the private sector, Congress appoints the advisory board. So I was like, don't need an advisory board, thank you. And so then I was like, okay, well, how about I have an event? And we'll just invite a bunch of people and we can talk about stuff. Well, it turns out if you're gonna have an event, then you need the Office of Public Affairs to approve it. And since this project was with the White House and the General Services Administration, we had two offices of public affairs who would have to approve it, which I could have done. But then I realized I could hold a meeting and invite some people. And as long as they weren't getting anything out of it, which they weren't because I didn't really have anything to give them, then I didn't have to, really get approval from anybody except for like the people to book the room with. So it's amazing how you can just, sometimes you don't have to change the rules. You just like use them and use the right words. So the other policy story I want to tell you is about the VA. So I'll tell you the story quick because I think I'm over time already. And when I came to government in 2013, I worked for the Smithsonian, and I was told that so the Smithsonian is a private-public trust, so it's kind of a different thing than an agency, and they had a contract with Amazon to use the cloud. So people were like, yay, you get to use the cloud. And I was like, okay, well, other agencies, they're not as high-tech as the Smithsonian. But it turns out, people told me that in the VA, it was illegal to use the cloud, which I had trouble wrapping my brain around. But they used to actually use it as an interview question at the United States Digital Service, like, what would you do if somebody told you the cloud was illegal? Instead of a question about empathy and discovery. So it turns out that at some point in the 1900s, when computers were newer and we hadn't invented virtualization yet, they, in some act that included regulations, they said if there's ever a security breach at the VA, you have to take the hard drive and put it in an evidence bag. So we can't put the cloud in an evidence bag, therefore, it's illegal. So, it was probably a year and a half, 2 years that this was you just couldn't use the cloud at the VA, and all the people at the VA were very sad about that. And then one of my colleagues, I think it was Noah Kunin, who worked with me at 18F, came up with the fix. He proposed this to the lawyers, and it totally flew, that if you redefine, if you change the definition of a hard drive to say we have a virtual hard drive, then you could say we have a virtual bag. And if you're the, a general counsel at one of these agencies or at the White House, you can interpret laws. And then he wrote down some guidance, right, that this is exactly how you would deal with a security breach and how you would put your virtual hard drive into a virtual bag. So that's kind of awesome. So you're saying to yourself, that's crazy government shit. Sorry. That wouldn't happen where I work. I mean, maybe some of you work in bureaucratic places, maybe some of you work for the government, but most of you are probably working in a cool shop and you're like, hey, yeah, we got it together. So I want to just kind of give you a look-see about what your stack looks like. So on your coding stack, you've got code review, automated test, metrics, CI/CD. You probably have some company policy about who has access to what. You've got a privacy policy in TOS, and you've got the lawyers protecting you from the actual laws. And if the things you want to be doing and the things you think you should be doing aren't encoded in these kinds of policies, then, there may be some errors in your system. Likewise, when you're hiring to the staffing side, you've got job posting, hiring process, Maybe if you're lucky, you have an onboarding process. You probably have an employee handbook, HR policy, and then there's that scary law thing. And so this is where there is rarely policy. And this is where, when things aren't encoded, people make arbitrary decisions. So I'd highly recommend that you write things down. Think about why are you hiring somebody? If anybody says, like, I don't really like their style, I'm not sure they're a culture fit, I'm tempted to get snarky with people like that. But what I've learned is curiosity wins, right? Oh, what part of our culture do you think that they don't fit in with? And hopefully they will say, well, they don't do test-driven development or something rational, right? Like something that actually has to do with the work, right? Not like they don't like to play ping pong on Fridays. But then you can be curious and say, do you think that they wouldn't want to learn that? Did you ask them that in the interview? And some of you can find holes in your process. So I'm a big fan of checklists, pre-mortems, retrospectives. And talk about why you do the things you do with your colleagues. Because this why makes you start to realize the things you value. Because we want to be biased for amazing software developers with great potential who can learn fast and do awesome things. We don't want to be biased against people with arbitrary attributes that have nothing to do with software engineering. So, we live in an imperfect world. Our reality isn't finished yet. But we have the opportunity to create good rules together. And when you figure out what works, whether it's these people system things, or whether it's some code you wrote or some code you recently learned about, I'd encourage you to tell the story in all of its messy, epic detail. Thank you.